Today's episode of Expanded Perspectives is sponsored by Gaia.com. Help find your own truth by exploring perspectives you won't find in the mainstream on some of life's biggest mysteries. Whether it's grand conspiracies, breakaway societies, UFOs, ancient civilizations, lost wisdom, as well as the paranormal, all at your fingertips. Stream videos anywhere from your living room or on the go with the Gaia app, available through the App Store or Google Play, which gives you access to over 7,000 titles, all available to you with a monthly plan for only $9.95 a month. If you sign up now, your first month is only 99 cents. There are multiple plans to choose from, including a three-month plan and an annual plan. You'll have access to incredible shows available only on Gaia, like Truth Hunter, Buzzsaw, Cosmic Disclosure, Beyond Belief, Missing Links, Hidden Origins, and Deep Space, and much, much more. Gaia is available on your Android or iPhone, Roku, Apple TV, and Amazon Fire TV. If you enjoy expanding your perspective, then you'll enjoy Gaia.com. That's GAIA.com/expanded perspectives. All one word, folks. GAIA.com/expanded perspectives. Let's start the show.
And thank you all so much for joining us here on Expanded Perspectives today. That's right, folks. You're here again. We're going to have some fun. It's me. It's Cam. And as always, the man that probably truly needs no introduction by now, I'm going to go ahead and do it. The Prince of Parker County, the Dubtown Demon, the man himself, the Great Beast, Kyle Filson.
How's it going, everybody? I'm here. I'm back from Austin, ready to go. Fully charged. My batteries have been reset. I feel awesome, man. We'll be talking about more of that from our trips and adventures in Austin in the outro section of the show.
Yeah,
but Cam,
I'm
excited, man. I had a good Easter. I'm ready to go. I ate a little too much, but I watched the kids hunt for eggs, and it was all, you know, it was a good time, man.
I did not, dude. I reeled it back. First of all, my daughter loves to bake, okay? She's really got into baking since she was probably 10 or 11. She got into it.
Right.
And she's getting really good at it. That's the wild thing is, because I think there's so much information online now that anybody, you know, can figure out how to do just about anything if you're willing to do a little research and study. And so that's what she's done. She's really got into it. So she decided to take and she made these cupcakes that look like they've got dirt on top, but it's like some kind of chocolate cookie crumble.
Right.
And then she took icing and dyed the icing, like food coloring, a bright orange, and then dipped strawberries in them and made it look like a carrot coming out of the ground, out of
right,
the top of
right,
that.
Right.
I ate two of them, and that was too many. I didn't know they had chocolate filling. I didn't know how she does this, because she doesn't tell Dad. She's like, here, Pop, try this. I eat it, and then I'm like in a sugar coma. Dude, it's one of those things. I ate perfect amount until I got to that. And that was too much. You know, sometimes you eat too many sweets.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to have the Alka-Seltzer, baby. And it'll plop, plop, fizz, fizz for Daddy, because I think I'm going to be tore up. I'm assuming, folks, right quick, and I know you should never assume, that most of you are probably listening to this at work or at school or in a commute, you know, somewhere like that. And it's probably early. A lot of you listen to it probably early. And you don't like early. If you're like me and Kyle, we don't like early. I like to get up early sometimes, but I don't like to have to think early, if that makes sense. I like to just kind of live, get in the groove first of the morning. You know
yeah,
what I mean?
I'm totally a night owl. Yeah, I mean, like, yeah. Just working on this show, most of the time, yes. I don't even start my work till after 9 p.m., just simply because that's after when the kids all go to sleep.
Yeah, things start relaxing around, things like that. Yeah. So you look at this, and somebody's done some research into this, folks. This comes from the independent.co.uk. The headline grabbed my attention of ban 9 a.m. lectures for students, experts say. Now, I'm all about banning them for everybody. Anything before 9, no. But what it says is researchers say traditional education and work start times of 9 a.m. mean young adults are likely to underperform as a result of learning at a time which feels unnatural to them. And I couldn't agree more. It says traditionally, 9 a.m. lectures, they believe, should be scrapped. And students should be allowed to start their day later. Now, experts have claimed that there's a new research that suggests that early mornings interfere with young adults' body clocks. Now, this is researchers at the Open University. It says lectures should start, now get a load of this, no earlier than 11 a.m. for students to perform their best. Now, they started working with some University of Nevada researchers, and these experts analyzed study patterns of 200 students, and they found academic performance was best between 11 a.m. and 9:30 p.m. Now, Paul Kelly of the Open University, this is what Paul said. Said students do better if they can target their study time to align with their personal rhythm and at the end of the day when they know they are most effective.
Right. It makes sense.
Well, it's like you just said, you're a night owl.
Yeah.
You get more done in the evenings.
Well, you know,
that's when you need to do your work. That's when you feel the most productive.
Right, and sometimes that doesn't even work out. I mean, like, to create a podcast, just like anything else, is like, it's kind of like being like an artist almost. You have to feel inspired. There are times where I know I have time set aside to work on the show, and I'm just like, man, I'm not feeling it today. I don't force myself. I'm just like, nope, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to wait until I feel like I want to do it, and then it seems like it just flows. Like, I know you do because we do this all the time. But for people that are wondering, it's like some days it starts to be a struggle to do the research, but then you'll hit something and it'll just flow. And what I've learned over time is don't fight it. If you don't feel like you can do it right now, don't do it. Go do something else.
Well, we have a lot of friends that listen to this show that are, you know, graphic artists, painters, sculptors, I mean, tattoo artists. We have a ton of that. And to me, I mean, that's even musicians, that's an art form. And you would always hear them talk about all this art and how they did it and how you get into the flow. And like you said, I never really knew what they were talking about until you start really trying to make something. And you do. You have to kind of have your juices flowing. And that's what they're tapping into.
That's what they're saying in this article, basically.
Well, it's exactly that. And they even talked to, they said that the shift is at its greatest. This puberty, okay, this is what's going on. There's biological changes, they say, that begin in the puberty shift of natural wake and sleep times, okay? And this is by up to 3 hours later in the day. This is when it starts. So they say that actually they believe that having to get up early is actually a possibility. It's being linked to students' mental health problems.
Yeah, because if you're not a morning person, I can see how it could be detriment to you.
And it's that puberty. It's that shift that they're talking about.
Yeah.
And this shift happens at the greatest at around 19 years of age. And then it says reverting to an earlier pattern when adults hit their mid-20s. So it's actually, when the younger you are, the later you should wake up, the later you should get started. So but I'm still along the line that I believe everything should start a little bit later. I believe it should be one of those deals that you should start when it's comfortable for you to start. Because I know there's certain things that I like to do in the mornings and certain things that I don't. And thinking, like real critical thinking, is not something you want to be able to in a rush for. And if you have a lecture at 9 or you have to be at your job, like I have to be there at 8 a.m. Some days I have to be there at 7. Some days, you know, at 6 a.m., things like that. You don't want to be in there and trying to do critical thinking after you've only been up 30, 45 minutes.
Especially if you're not a morning person.
Exactly.
Luckily, with technology, I think we're going to be able to do away with that simply because I think these professors should be just videotaping their lectures. You download them and watch them at your leisure.
Yes.
You know, I really do think the classic classroom situation is probably going to go away in the next 20 years, don't you think?
Yeah, I think so. Well, especially, I'm going to read this to you. This comes from Open University. This is what they said about this study. Education and work generally starts at a fixed time, mostly early, with no adjustments for different chronotypes among those who study work. They go on to say this, however, in adolescence and early adulthood, optimal wake and sleep times are shifted 2 to 3 hours later in the day. And yet this group, they are still required to conform to educational start times more appropriate to young children or older adults. So that mid, you know, end of your teen years, early part of your 20 year is your body's making that shift. So what they say is this, if universities were to choose a new standard starting time, this group suggests this. Anywhere between 11 a.m. and 1 p.m. would be close to optimal for the average undergrad student. So you have to imagine, I mean, the weight that they have of all the stuff that they're learning and working on anyway.
Right.
Not to mention you're trying to sleep off a hangover lots of times because you've been out partying a little much.
Right.
You need 11 a.m. is what would be a good time to go.
Right. And you should be able to choose. You're an adult. Choose.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Now, there's an interesting story posted over on Phantoms and Monsters from my bud and brud, Lon Strickler over there, about a woman who called in from Santa Cruz, California. She called in to Coast to Coast AM recently and told George Napa an interesting story that her father told her that happened to him one time when he went camping. Now, check this out. She said, I'm telling you, my father had one heck of a story that he told me several times throughout his life. Now, this story took place in the early 1950s when this all happened, and he later went into a very high level of law enforcement. He was a policeman at the time, and he actually saw a UFO, and it was in the newspaper, and then we kept that newspaper clipping. He was looking up into the sky with this other policeman, and he said it was huge, just huge. He said, the pivotal story is, and I'm thinking now it was connected, that I didn't realize what he'd seen shortly after, and I did not connect it with the men in black either. He said that he and his buddies went up into the mountains to go fishing. This was about 6 months later after he saw this UFO, and they were around the fire. He said it was about 11 o'clock at night, and he said literally, out of the bushes and trees, these two men in black, like funeral black suits, walked up to the fire, and he said the weird thing was they had dark sunglasses on. When he started telling the story, I was about 5 years old, and I'm 68 years old now. He said they were very pale. They had long hands, and he poked his buddy as he pointed down. There was dust everywhere, but their shoes, he said, they weren't dusty. He said it was the creepiest thing. They didn't speak to them. Very tall, very pale, he said, not monstrous looking, but strange looking, and they didn't speak at all. They were there about maybe 15 minutes in front of the fire, and then they turned and they walked into the bushes. He said, I think they disappeared, but I don't know. But it was just strange. He said, we looked at each other and there was this sense of foreboding, of evil, he said. Let's get the heck out of here, he told his buddy, and they both left. Now, George Knapp, of course, the host, asked her to clarify the time this event happened when her father told her the story, and she said he first started telling her this when she was around 5 or 6, but he kept telling her the same story all the way into her teens, and even 10 years after that, when she was in her early 20s, he started telling other people, and he said he didn't know what it was. Now, he's been dead about 10 years now, and up until his deathbed, Cam, he stuck to this story. So, while being on patrol as a policeman, mm-hmm. him and his buddy see a UFO, and 6 months later, they're camping, fishing, and 11 o'clock at night, just up out of the woods, two men in black show up, and they don't talk. First thing,
you got to be some tough men in black if you want to start.
Well, apparently, you
something bad could happen.
They felt intimidated, but I yeah. know if I was camping, you know, this just makes sense. I'm not saying the story is bullshit. I'm just saying, if you were camping and two guys walked up in black, I mean, would you allow them just to stand there for 15 minutes? Wouldn't you be like, can I help you?
Especially if you were an officer.
Yeah.
You know, if you already had that kind of training ingrained in you, is you're going to want to know, can I help you with something? Is everything all right? You know, what's going on?
Well, that's what you'd think would happen. But I think this, and just like many of the other cases that I've read about these men in black, is it's almost like they put you in some kind of trance.
Like something goes, yeah, like you're right. It is like that.
Like,
yeah.
Same thing with the black-eyed kids. Like you mm-hmm. were like, well, if one showed up to me, I would just kick them or something like that.
Yeah.
But in reality, yeah. everybody that's ever seen one says, man, it's like I couldn't do anything. Like yeah. I was paralyzed.
Yeah.
with fear, and I couldn't do anything. And I think that's probably what happened in this situation, is him and his buddy didn't know what to do till they walked off. And then he was like, man, let's get out of here. I don't blame him, but what a bizarre story, all the way from the 1950s.
Yeah, well, it's funny you keep bringing up the black-eyed kid thing, because I actually have a black-eyed sighting.
Right on.
Yeah, now, of course, Lon posted this, and this comes from his friend and our good friend, and we've had him on before, Albert Rosales, some of his research. This actually took place in 1994, Navajo Summit, Arizona. Says it was a cold evening. I had my two nieces with me. One was 6, the other 8. I had gone to our family cabin, waiting on my sister to return from town. The evening started about 7 p.m., and we didn't have a key to the house. So we waited for a couple of hours. The girls eventually fell asleep in my truck. As the night grew later, the temperature also dropped. I fell asleep as well. I woke around 9:30 p.m., and it was very cold in the truck. I started the vehicle. As I depressed the brake pedal to start the truck, I noticed in the side mirror a face looking at me from the glow in the taillight. I hesitated to look at first, but gathered enough courage to look. I saw a white face with long gray and white hair and black eyes looking at me. I freaked. Once I started the truck, I sped off, headed to the highway, not sure if what I saw was following us. It was. I felt as if it jumped into the bed of my truck. I turned west to head towards a town called Ganado. I went as fast as I could to my parents' house. Upon reaching the turnoff, I noticed it jumped out of the truck and run alongside the right-of-way of the fence. As I pulled up to the house, I quickly carried my nieces inside. Once inside, I situated the girls for bed. Later that night, I dreamed I walked about 2 miles to my aunt's house. No one was home. As I walked back home, I noticed this thing paralleling me. I quickly ran home, went inside, and locked the door behind me, and went to bed. As I woke the next morning, I noticed sand and dirt at the foot of my bed. I told my parents of what had happened and of what I had dreamed. They took me to a medicine man, and he told me that I actually sleepwalked to my aunt's house, and when I entered the house, it followed me in. Totally Ooh. Freaked me out.
Yeah, that's right? Creepy.
Yeah, look, it's... What if that's the way it works? Like, in the dream state... That's what he did. He sleepwalked to his aunt's, and then this thing was just out there with him.
Yeah.
Wow. No thanks. No thanks. But what could, look, could you imagine, like, you're sitting up there, like, hey, first of all, where's his sister? You know, what took her so long to get back to the cabin? They're like, come on, man, need to hurry. I'm sitting out here, and this black-eyed Gandalf thing is standing around on the outside, the Gandalf the White, on the outside of the truck, looking at you.
Man, that's terrifying.
You gas it, and it jumps in the bed of the truck.
Yeah.
We'd have had to do some Dukes of Hazzard moves, baby. I'd have been cutting some Brodies and just slinging, you know, donuts, trying to throw that sucker out.
The Fate of the Furious moves like that.
Yeah, right. Whatever I could do to get it out of there.
Hey, man, you ever get like a craving for something that you want? Like in town, like you're like, man, I sure could go for a hamburger or something like that.
Yeah, I just
really have a craving.
Yeah, thing? Yeah, it's funny, but yeah, I do get those.
Everybody
sometimes.
Does. Yeah. But luckily, we're all adults, or most of us are, that's listening to this show. You can get in your car and you can go, but if you're young and you're below the age of driving, you don't have that option.
Yeah.
Apparently, that's not true, though.
Oh,
recently, an
no.
8-year-old drove him and his sister.
I know where you're going.
An 8-year-old drove him and his sister to McDonald's because he said he was craving a burger. Check this out. An 8-year-old Ohio boy wanted a cheeseburger, and he wanted it so bad that he got behind the wheel of his dad's van and took matters into his own hands. Says one of the problems he had was he didn't know how to drive, but it didn't take him long to figure it out. The boy said it was simple. He said he just watched some YouTube videos on how to drive a car. And within just a few minutes, he chauffeured his kid's sister effortlessly to the McDonald's a half mile from his East Palestine home, while his parents were sleeping. The witnesses said the 8-year-old obeyed all traffic laws, like making sure to stop properly at red lights, waiting for traffic to pass before taking a left turn, and he stayed within the speed limits. They said when the two siblings pulled up through the drive-through window with a piggy bank with money in tow, the McDonald's workers were convinced that this was all a prank. The workers thought that the parents were probably hiding in the back, but obviously they weren't. Now, the responding patrolman, a guy named Jacob Kohler, told WFMJ the interesting story. He said when confronted by the police, the boy realized that he had done something wrong and told Kohler through tears that he just really wanted a cheeseburger, man. He said the children did get to eat the McDonald's cheeseburger while they waited for their grandparents to come pick them up, and there were no charges that were filed. So that's crazy. His parents, I guess, are dead asleep. Now, it doesn't say what the circumstances were, if they were alcoholics or drug abusers. It doesn't get into any of that. But I guess he woke up in the morning and he wanted a cheeseburger. So he's like, hey, guess what? He's eight. It doesn't even tell you how old his kid's sister was. But he's like, hey, let's just go get in the van and go get some cheeseburgers.
It's funny you bring this up because I actually looked into this when I first read about it. He's 8 years old. His sister's five. The father had been working late and come home and went to sleep. The wife was watching the kids and then she fell asleep on the couch.
Right.
And
we've all done it.
Yeah. You know, yeah. Yeah. You know, because you hear the kids playing around. You just take a little nap. They wake up if they're making noise. Yeah. The brother was like, you want some nuggets? Let's do this.
Yeah, the brother
jumped in there
and they went. It'd be like the brother and taking Luke.
I'm not even going to joke around. I could see those boys doing that. Yeah. 100%. You could see them. You'd look at them and be like, oh, no. Here we go again.
How smart is that kid, though? Yeah. I mean, that's the same thing I do. Whenever I want to learn how to do something, I go to YouTube. That's like the first place I go.
Goes to YouTube. I was laughing because of this. In the state of Texas, I think you have to be over the age of 10 before they can even really charge you with any sort of crime.
Yeah, you
like
may be
even
right.
If you stole something, I think you have to be over the age of 10 before they can even really pursue. So if you're, you know, as I say pursue it, like even give you or your parents, you know, get you in trouble for it. So if you're 8 years old and you violated zero traffic laws, the only thing you're doing is driving without a license.
That's it.
That's it. What is it, a warning? They just give the kid a warning. They're like, look, dude, you can't be doing this.
Yeah.
But it's really hard to say you can't when he just did it just fine.
I know, that's funny. Yeah. I mean, it must have been a fairly large 8-year-old, too, because, I mean, he didn't mention anything about having difficulty
maybe
reaching
it's a little
the
van.
Pedals.
Maybe just a real small van.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, I loved it. I love
that story.
Yeah, I do.
Well, all right, folks. Well, let's take a break. And after the break, I'm going to be talking about a bizarre missing person case known as the Sodder Family Murders. Stick with us, folks. You're listening to Expanded Perspectives. When it comes to missing person cases, there are some that seem to defy imagination. Some that seem so bizarre, it's difficult for people to wrap their minds around them. There are those which seem to continually and persistently baffle and perplex those who would try to dig into them to find any answers. These are the cases that seem to become even stranger and stranger and more confusing the more we investigate them, oftentimes posing far more questions than answers. It's these types of cases that interest me the most, and on today's show, I'm going to be talking about one of the most frustrating and confusing cases in American history. It's a story about a family who lost their house and five of their children to a fiery inferno, only to be taunted and tortured for the rest of their days with continual, mysterious clues and evidence suggesting that the children had perhaps survived. It is a case surrounded by so many puzzling clues, mysterious people, conspiracy theories, and bizarre facts that there can be no doubt that it is one of the strangest and most tragic cases of unsolved disappearances. The story begins on Christmas Eve, 1945, in Fayetteville, West Virginia. Fayetteville, at the time, was your typical small, rural, Appalachian town with a meager population of only about 1,500 people. George and Jenny Sauter had been celebrating the Christmas season with 9 of their 10 children. One of their children, Joe, was in the military and was stationed far away and could not make it home this season for the holidays. Well, they started by enjoying a big family dinner, like most, with turkey and ham and dressing and mashed potatoes, sweet potatoes, a broccoli and cheese casserole, homemade rolls, and of course, a few pies. It was a happy occasion, with all of the children in excited expectations for the Christmas holidays and the holiday season and all that it brings with it. And of course, the thoughts of the gifts and the toys that they would all soon be receiving. After dinner, the children helped clean up, and after the dishes were done and the silverware put away, they begged and begged, could they please just open one present tonight? Please! And then they would happily go to bed and wait until the next morning to open the rest. Well, after a few moments of desperate pleading, Jenny Sauter, the mother, agreed, and Marion, who was 17 years old, one of the older sisters, volunteered to give her gifts that joyous night. Hours later, after the celebrating had died down, well, it was time for bed. And, like most kids, they didn't want to go to bed. 5 of the family's children, Maurice, who was 14, Martha, who was 12, Louis, who was 10, Jenny, who was 8, and Betty, who was 6, begged and begged to be allowed to stay up late so that they could play with the presents that they had received from their older sister, Marion. Jenny Sauter, being in the Christmas spirit, reluctantly agreed to let them stay up after making them promise to turn off the lights and lock the doors before they went to bed. And then she went to sleep with her husband and their other children, 23-year-old John, 16-year-old George Jr., and 2-year-old daughter, Sylvia. In the dark, cold, early morning hours of Christmas morning, Jenny Sauter was jolted awake by the ringing of their phone. It was odd to get a call at such a late hour, but she nevertheless roused herself from bed and went to answer it as her husband and Sylvia slept. When Jenny picked up the phone, there was an unfamiliar woman on the other end of the line and the sound of laughter, chatter, and the clinking of glasses could be heard in the background, as if there was some kind of party going on. The stranger asked to speak with a man who Jenny did not know, and she politely informed the caller that she must have the wrong number. Well, the woman on the other end of the line let out a little nervous laugh and hung up the phone. It was at this time that Jenny noticed that the lights were still on downstairs, and she assumed that the other children, who had stayed up, had probably forgotten to turn them off. When Jenny went downstairs, she found that not only were all of the lights on, but the curtains were still wide open and the front door was unlocked, which was very odd because the children had promised to close up before going to bed, and they weren't known to just leave the door unlocked and all of the lights on. Puzzled by the why the kids would do this, Jenny went about locking up, closing the curtains, and turning off all the lights before going back up to bed. As Jenny Sauter began to drift off to sleep, once again at around 1:30 a.m., she was yet again shocked awake. This time, by a sudden loud noise that sounded like a rock or a ball hitting the roof and then rolling down the side of the house. Not long after that, tendrils of smoke began to snake through the air of the room, and Jenny rushed out to see what was going on. It soon became apparent that one of the rooms of the house which was used as an office, was on fire. She woke up the others in a panic. Jenny and George rushed through the hallway screaming for everyone to get up and get out of the house. As the flames and thick smoke spread at an alarming rate, they rushed out onto the front lawn where they did a head count. The oldest boys, John and George Jr., made it out of the house as well as the oldest girl, Marion, who ran out with baby Sylvia. Jenny and George, of course, also made it out. When George was outside and saw that five of his children were still inside, he tried everything possible to re-enter the home and save them. He first broke out a window, and in doing so, he cut his arm very badly. Through all the smoke, he saw that flames covered the entire first floor of the house. He then ran to a rain barrel to get buckets of water to try to extinguish the fire. But to his dismay, he found that the water was frozen solid due to the cold winter weather. Thinking quickly, he ran to where he always kept his ladder, but it had mysteriously vanished. He attempted and failed to climb the house by hand. In one last ditch effort and one last attempt, he and his sons thought to pull their work trucks up to the house to climb on top of them to get inside the top floor. Their terrible luck continued when they found that their trucks would not start due to the frigid and cold weather. The engine simply would not turn over, even though they had worked perfectly fine the previous day. Other unfortunate events seemed to almost maliciously conspire against the family. Efforts to scoop water from a water barrel were thwarted when the water proved to be frozen solid. Daughter Marion rushed to a neighbor's house to call the fire department, but was unable to get through. And still yet another neighbor who had seen the blaze, well, they too tried calling and was likewise unable to reach an operator. In the end, one of the neighbors physically drove into town to contact the fire department directly. And in the meantime, the house was totally consumed by the unusually fierce fire. The whole structure was razed to the ground within 45 minutes. Unbelievably, due to the archaic phone tree system used by the department at the time, in which one fireman calls another, who calls another, and so on to mobilize, the fire department would not arrive until 8 a.m., long after the entire solder house had been reduced by the aggressive fire to ash and smoking debris, piled atop the ruined basement. Maurice, 14, Martha, 12, Louis, 10, Jenny, 8, and Betty, 6, never got out of the house, and it was presumed that they had died in the horrific fire. The police arrived on the scene in the morning after, and only a 2-hour investigation was conducted. It concluded that the fire was started by faulty wiring. George argued that that couldn't be so because he had just gotten the wiring totally redone earlier that summer. And besides, he said several of the lights had stayed on well after the fire had even started. The reports at the time claimed that there had been no remains whatsoever found in the ash and rubble. A coroner and the fire chief both stated that the house had burned down far too breathtakingly quickly to have completely reduced the bodies completely to ash, as corpses normally take around 2 hours of burning at 2,000 degrees in order to do this, and the house had totally been burned to the ground in less than an hour. By all accounts, there should have been some skeletons there amongst the ashes and incinerated debris, but there was nothing there at all. The whole town was consumed with grief and despair. Everyone gathered around the remaining Sauter family to try and help them during this incredibly difficult time. Now, without a home, the Sauter family was put up by many of the neighbors. People volunteered in any way they could by preparing meals, taking care of the remaining children, offering guidance, and sometimes just a shoulder to cry on. It was a difficult time for that family and the town itself, but the people of Fayetteville pulled it together. a few days after the fire, George Sauter plowed over what was left of his home and planted flowers there in memory of his children, though the fire marshal advised against doing so. But he didn't care. In fact, George didn't believe his children were dead at all. He refused to believe it. George and Jenny believed that their children had been kidnapped and that the fire was intentionally set to cover the crime scene. Now, you might be thinking that, well, he's probably just grieving. He's grasping at straws. He's distraught. He's not thinking clearly. And that's why he's refusing to let go. And I admit, I was feeling the same way. But it turns out that George, he may not have been crazy after all. You see, there were witnesses, several of them, and rumors that supported his beliefs. Well, the Sauters decided to launch their own investigation, and they began to uncover some odd details that quickly cast the case into a more sinister light. George recalled that a few months before the fire broke out, a man had come to the house asking about work, hauling coal for his business, and the stranger had made an offhand comment about how the house's two fuse boxes that were bound to cause a fire someday. At the time, George had thought nothing of it, but it became rather ominous and disturbingly prescient in retrospect. Adding to this were claims made by the older Sauter children that they had recently been seeing a van on several occasions parked along the nearby U.S. Highway 21, whose driver had appeared to be intently watching the younger children as they walked home from school. On the night of the terrible fire, a strange man was witnessed by some neighbors stealing from the Sauter's garage as the fire was burning. He had stolen the ladder and attempted to cut the power line, but instead accidentally cut the phone line. The ladder was found away from the house down an embankment. For some strange reason, this man was never closely looked at as a possible suspect. He was only ordered to pay fines for stealing. There was a bus driver who saw what they claimed was fireballs being thrown onto the house before the fire started. This claim was further backed up the following spring when little Sylvia found a green shell in the yard. The Sauters showed the object to a military friend who believed it to be an explosive device, similar to a small napalm-like bomb. It was a small incendiary device, and it's probably what caused the loud bang that Jenny heard on the roof that ultimately started the fire. There was a woman who claimed to have seen the children in a passing car while the fire was in progress. A woman at a tourist stop 50 miles west of the Sauter home says she saw the kids the morning after the fire and served them breakfast. They left in a vehicle with Florida license plates on it. Even stranger, another woman believed she saw four of the five missing children at her hotel in Charleston, South Carolina. She said they were with two men and two women, and that she tried to speak to the children, but the adults looked hostile and wouldn't allow it. They then spoke to the kids in Italian, and that the whole party stopped speaking to her. According to her, they checked in near midnight, but the exact date she couldn't remember. All she knows is they left early the very next morning. Most people believe that her story was not reliable enough for further investigation. Jenny, well, she did her own research, using chicken bones and the stove, and could never get them to completely be destroyed by the fire. Her and George's belief was strengthened more when another local home was burned to the ground and seven skeletons were found in the debris. With all these possible leads, the Sauters went to the authorities to have their case reopened, but the police refused because they believed no crime had taken place. They weren't going to have that, so the Sauters even approached the FBI, but were told that it was a local case, and that was not in their jurisdiction, and that they could not do anything unless local law enforcement allowed it, which they didn't. there was, in fact, a shocking lack of any cooperation from law enforcement or the fire department. And it was as if the authorities just wanted the whole thing to just go away. Without any help, it was left up to the family to pursue the matter on their own, which they did. In 1949, George, with the help of others, dug up the site of his former home, looking for any remains that might have been accidentally overlooked. Reports claimed that pieces of bone and possible human organs had been found. The organ found was tested in a lab and found to be a relatively fresh beef liver. Some say that it was planted there in an attempt to cover up shoddy police work. A private investigator thought that the fire chief had actually planted the organ there himself, perhaps thinking that if some remains were found, then the family would stop their private investigation into the incident. It was reported that four pieces of vertebrae and two small bones, possibly belonging to a child's hand, had been found. A medical expert involved in the case stated that it would be very unlikely for all the other remains to be destroyed in such a quick burning fire. This expert believes the remains came from a 14 or 15-year-old child, which would match Maurice's age. George did not believe these bones belonged to his son because of the location they were found. Years later, after more testing on the bones, another expert stated that the remains belonged to a person between 16 and 22 years of age, and that the bones showed no signs of being damaged in a fire. Some think that the bones were placed there from a nearby graveyard as a cover-up, but there is nothing that supports these theories. 6 years after the tragedy, the Sodders made one last attempt to find any new leads on their case. They put up a billboard at the site of the fire with the pictures of all five of their missing children, along with the story of what happened that night. They even offered a $5,000 reward to anyone who could find their children. Without any luck, they raised the reward to $10,000, but still to no avail. Over the following years, tantalizing clues and leads suggesting that the children were still alive would continue to come in. In one instance, George was looking at a photo of school children from New York City and was positive he could see his missing daughter Betty among them. He was so convinced that the girl in the photo was his daughter that he immediately drove all the way to New York to speak with the family, but they refused to talk to him or show him the girl when he arrived. In another potential lead, a letter from St. Louis claimed that the oldest daughter, Martha, was living in a convent there. And in yet another, it was claimed that the children had been whisked off to Italy to live with a distant relative of Jenny's. Sightings of the children popped up all over the place, with rumors swirling that they had ended up in an orphanage. George spent years hiring private investigators and driving around the country, following up on leads that all went nowhere. Yet he never gave up, and he never gave up hope that the truth was out there somewhere. Perhaps the most mysterious potential lead came in 1968, in the wake of a magazine article on the case written by a detective. One morning, Jenny Sodder went out to her mailbox to find an envelope addressed specifically to her and postmarked from Kentucky, but with no return address. Inside the envelope was a picture of a young man in his mid-20s who bore a striking resemblance to their son, Louise, who had been 9 at the time of the fire. On the back of the photograph was written a mysterious message that reads, "Louis Sodder, I love brother Frankie, little boys, A90132 or 35. Authorities deemed it a twisted hoax, but the Sodders became so convinced that it was their missing son that they hired a private investigator to go over to Kentucky to try and track down where the letter had come from. In an eerie turn of events, the private investigator departed for Kentucky only to vanish without a trace, never to be heard from again. The identity of the man in the photograph, the origin of the letter, the meaning of the cryptic message written on the photograph, and what became of the missing investigator have never been found, and all remain a perplexing mystery to this day. People who have gotten intrigued with the Sodders' story have studied the case, point out that George owned a local coal trucking business. At the time, this industry was under a lot of pressure from the mafia, so some thought the gang was involved with the disappearance of the children. After all, the Sodders were of Italian descent, and the number 90132 that was on the back of the photo was, at the time, the postal code for Palermo, Sicily. George Sodder died in 1969, and Jenny in 1989. The majority of people believe that the Sodder children perished in the fire that night, and that the Sodders just refused to accept it. There are also those who believe that the kids were kidnapped and possibly taken to Italy. The youngest Sodder child, Sylvia, who was only an infant at the time, is still trying to figure out what happened to her siblings that night. This has to go down in history as one of the most confusing and most frustrating missing children cases of all time. What really happened on Christmas Eve 1945 in Fayetteville, West Virginia, to the Sodders and their children? Did George owe the mafia a lot of money and simply never confessed it to his wife? I mean, relationships between husband and wife were far different in 1945 than they are now. Men were known to keep secrets from their spouses, and women were instructed not to ask questions. Or was it the man in the strange van seen spying on the children as they walked home from school? Who the hell was the guy seen cutting phone wires from a ladder stolen out of the Sodders' garage while the house was burning? Who was later caught and then only fined? Did the fire chief purposely plant a liver in order to make the Sodders stop the private investigations into the matter? The whole thing doesn't make sense. I feel like I'm not getting the whole story. To this day, no one knows what really happened to the missing Sodder children. Maybe they did burn up in the fire. Or maybe George knew far more than he ever let on. I believe he did. And that's why he spent the rest of his life searching for his missing children. Because he knew they weren't dead. You're listening to Expanded Perspectives. And we're back with Expanded Perspectives. I like the missing person tales, but especially ones like this that are unsolved and they don't know what happened. I mean, there was a house fire that, you know, burned up. Supposedly all five children burned up in the fire, even though everybody said that the fire didn't burn hot enough or long enough to burn everybody's bones into ashes. There's all these bizarre things. It does make me think that the father knew more than he ever let on, and that's why the rest of his days he was constantly pursuing what happened to his children, because he knew something happened. They talked about him possibly having connections with nefarious characters in the mafia, and that maybe they abducted the children and took them away. I don't know. Very bizarre case, and that's why I liked it.
And yeah, and I don't want to cut you up, but and also the given the years of you're talking about mid 40s, you know, and that's a whole other thing. Is it's a lot. It would have been a lot easier for people to vanish than now. You know what I'm saying? Like, it seems like it'd have been easier for if you wanted to make people vanish, or like you're talking about an abduction. It just seems like things would have been easier then because it's harder to track stuff like that.
Well, and you're right. And I even bring up in the segment, it was that time period in the early 1945. You
45.
Know, that type of year, that time of in this country at that time, relationships between men and women were much different. So husband and wife, he might have had some secrets that he kept from his wife. And back then, women were taught, you know, you don't. He's the provider of the household. You don't interfere with his business. So it's not like today. It would be. I'm not saying it's right. I don't agree with that. I'm just saying, at that time, I could foresee something like that happen because he was steadfast to his dying breath that his kids were taken.
Yes.
And so I think that he knew a lot more than what was led on to the other people and what authorities knew. But it did look like the authorities even were kind of doing some odd behavior.
Well,
the whole thing is a really odd case. I mean, that's what makes it so interesting, is that it does not make any sense. Like I said, the more you look into it, the more confused it becomes, the more confused you become, and you end up asking more questions. I was driving myself crazy when I was researching this the other night. Is by the end of it, I just had so many more questions than when I started getting into it.
Well, and then, you know, with you start digging around and people want to start saying that it's been solved because they've got, what, one picture that they think looks like Lewis or whatnot?
Yeah.
Come on. You can't sit there and say it's been solved until you can DNA test these people.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you can't just, so we don't know. It's still one of those things that you wish. I guess that's where those cold cases are in any town. Every town's probably got a cold case. You know, and it just, I can't imagine being a family member. I mean, it wrenches my heart to no end to think about not having a closure. And then imagine being a father, because he's not, like you said, it feels like you're not telling the whole story.
Right.
You know, like you're holding something back that could be a real clue. And I guess it's one of those things is if you don't want to tell on yourself, what if you tell them and it turns out that's not what it is, but now they're all looking back at you again. So it goes, you know, it's a double-edged sword. Right. That's the problem, yeah.
Yeah, very, very cool. Well, speaking of something else that was cool, this last weekend we went to Austin, Texas for a business trip. And while on that business trip, we had a couple hours of downtime. And Cam took me to this zero-gravity floating spa. Now, I've had massages and stuff before, but I've never been to one of these floating spas, these deprivation tanks.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really, really cool. I mean, this thing is a giant cube. And the inside of it where you lay down, the water is filled with like 1,500 pounds of salt.
Mm-hmm. Epsom salt.
So that you float like a cork. I mean, you can't sink if you wanted to. You just bop right up. You float, and the water is the exact same temperature as your body. The air in the room is the exact same temperature as your body. And when you get in there and you shut the door, it is completely black. If any of you have ever been into a cavern, like Carlsbad Caverns or something, when the tour guide turns the light off, I mean, you can wave your hand directly in front of your face. You can't see anything. It's completely black. It's probably, if you ever get in one, it's the first time, if it's your first time in the tank, that your brain has been completely cut off from all senses. And, man, it is really cool. I laid in there, and if you splash around and stuff, you can tell you're in water. But if you just lay still and stay completely still for about 15 minutes, you start having some very strange sensations. You have sensations that you're spinning. You have sensations that you could be tumbling. I kept seeing where it looked, I don't know if it was blood in the blood vessels in my eyeballs that was causing this effect, but it's pitch black. Even with your eyes open, I can't see anything. It looked like I was going through tunnels. The only way I could describe it is, you remember the movie Stargate?
Mm-hmm.
When they go through the gate and they're going through that like tube, it looks like they're going really fast. You know what I'm talking about? Imagine that, but say slow it down 200 times. Like, I was moving through a tube where it looked purple would go by, but it was going very slow, like, and I couldn't figure out what it was. And then later, every time my heart would beat, I could see like the outline of my body kind of just move away from me. And I saw, you know, little, like, you know, what it looked like is, this is crazy because it's pitch dark, but somehow, some way, it looked like I saw like what looked like dark purple, like the only thing I could describe is jellyfish. Kind of moving ever so slight, like you'd think you could catch a glimpse, but when you concentrated, then it would kind of go away.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It was a really interesting experience. And I tell you, once I got into it, we were in there for 60 minutes. Yep. I felt like I was in there for about 12 minutes. I was like, whoa.
That's so funny.
That went by really quick. And then when I got out, you know, you have to shower off because, I mean, you are in really salty water. And showering off. And it really, I felt weird. I felt strange for a while.
It's hard to stand up, right?
Yeah. Well,
you feel like it's...
I don't know if I had hard trouble standing up, but I just felt not myself. But it was just a bizarre feeling because it's the first time I don't think I've ever experienced having all my senses cut off like that.
Yeah.
And but I did feel relaxed, more so than I have in a long time. Then we went and got an hour-long massage after that. So I feel like, you know, when you take your smartphone every once in a while, it's good to just turn the thing off, let it sit for about 10 minutes, and then turn it back on. I felt rejuvenated.
That's what
like,
you need.
Like I rebooted
a
little bit. So I felt really good. What did you, this is your second time in the tank. What did you think?
It was easier for me to get into the zone, if that makes any sort of sense, to really dial it in.
So kind of like riding a bicycle once you've been there?
Yeah. I mean, I jumped in and I knew what to expect. I knew what to focus on. I knew, and it's been a couple of years, you know, we even talked about it on the show when I did it the first time, but something that's almost like your body remembered. And I think the next time, you know, you and I go, you'll notice what I'm talking about. It seemed like it only took about 10 minutes this time. Like I slid right in. Every time my heart would beat, the outline of my body was in blue and I was seeing it and all that stuff. And it was just, like you said, I felt like I was tumbling at points, you know, from being in the box. And it's the ultimate relaxation. I really felt like I could feel myself stretching, like, you know, like your muscles were thoroughly relaxed and there's no pressure point being pushed. Like you're not like laying on a relaxing bed or in a comfy chair because it, everything is the perfect, because it's buoyancy. You know, it's not pressure holding you. It's the buoyancy of your own body.
Yeah. And if you quit moving, man, you truly feel like you're like, it's not floating.
Yeah.
You don't feel anything.
Yeah.
It's like your mind is like a camera, like you're seeing, but you don't have any sensation, no feeling at all.
I
know they make smaller ones that are like tanning beds. I don't think I've heard, I don't know, because it's my first time. I heard those aren't as good as this one. It was really big, so you have a lot of room.
Yeah.
I urge anybody to try it. I mean,
well, if it goes with, you know, if anybody wants to know, but if it goes for it, it's Zero Gravity Institute. Aubrey Marcus of On It, you know, he goes and floats there. They've taken Duncan Trussell there. Joe Rogan has floated there with Aubrey, and Joe has floated at Crash's, that float lab or whatever out there on the in L.A. And Joe has even said before that this is the other than that spot, this is the best spot he's ever been to see it. And the whole thing was amazing. I mean, it's worth doing. I urge anyone that has the ability to go give it a whirl, go try it one time. Just treat yourself. Go try it. If you live in Texas, you can get down around Austin somewhere. Go see Kevin. Check his spot out down there. That place is awesome. That's not the only place we went. We actually dropped in Bukowski's. Used to be Dandy's, but now it's Bukowski. Christopher and Wendy's spot. And... you've got to check this place out, folks. This is one of those deals. If you want a custom suit made,
not like just like a regular suit.
Well, they'll do them. They'll do like, regular, like I said, James Bond suits, the fancy to the nines. They'll do those suits.
But if you want to look like you just stepped out of Peaky Blinders,
this is the man to see.
Yeah, right. It's like vintage gentleman clothing. I mean, they had over 70,000 different swaths of clothing.
Yep.
That you, or fabric, I'm sorry, that you could have stuff made out of.
Yeah.
Bowler hats, top hats, vest. Go on there and check it out, their website. I mean, it is awesome. If you have a father or a boyfriend or a husband and you'd like to get a gift like that, like a pocket watch or a bow tie, that's the place to go to, man. It is really, really cool.
Well, and it's called, I got to make sure I get this right.
Bukowski.
Bukowski. Bukowski. Bukowski Tailor and Garb. It's there in Austin. And yeah, I mean, it's, I love them. They're great people. And the store is amazing because me and Kyle love that old school stuff. If you're into that kind of old school stuff, if you know your measurements and you've already got, you know, like, you know what size shirt you need, shoot it to Christopher. He'll knock it out. Literally, go check the stuff out. It was just fun because, I mean, they've been fans of the show for since we, you know, been down there the first time a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
And the whole thing. And it's just fun because we talked to him back and forth and it was great to go in there. But yeah. And for those of you asking about the meeting and what we ended up doing, it worked out very, very well. And we will probably have a surprise for y'all later on in the year. That's pretty much all I can say about it right now. due to a little piece of paper, but that's pretty much all I'm going to say is it's going to work out, and I think all of you are going to truly enjoy it once we let the cat out of the bag.
That's right, folks. And don't forget about our proud sponsors, Gaia and Upside. These are both two amazing companies. Don't forget, if you go over to gaia.com/expanded perspectives, you can go over there. They have over 7,000 titles and films, documentaries, yoga classes, meditation, and specialty shows like Deep Space, Buzzsaw, Beyond Belief with George Norrie, Truth Hunter with Linda Moulton Howe, and dozens and dozens and dozens more. Yeah, I suggest you go over there and check it out. That's gaia.com/expanded perspectives. Also, Upside. Don't forget, if you're a business person and you're traveling all the time, you can book your hotel and flights through Upside. That's UPSIDE.com, Upside.com. And if you go over there and you put the promo code BizTrip, BIZTRIP, you can save money and they will send you an Amazon gift card. And don't forget, if you support our sponsors, you're supporting our show. If you have stories of your own you would like to share, don't forget you can email us anytime at expandedperspectives@yahoo.com, and Mary will take care of those stories and filter them towards us. We love to read them. If you'd like to tell your story, you can always call the phone line, the hotline, 817-945-3828. And you can tell us your story if you'd like more and you're not already a member. Don't forget, we have an additional show every Friday called Expanded Perspectives Elite. It's $5 a month. And with that, you'll get an additional show every Friday, as well as access to the entire back catalog. And your $5 monthly donation helps the show out tremendously. If you'd like to help out the show beyond that, or if you just want to be a regular member, you can still go over to iTunes, Stitcher, write us a review. That always helps out. And we truly appreciate that. Cam?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Any big plans for the week?
Work. Just work. And I'm actually going to attempt to play my very first disc golf mini tournament this week.
Oh, there you go. Man, you should take your cameras and document some of that.
I don't know about that.
Somebody hold your phone or the GoPro or something. I want to see these tosses. I've never seen them throw one, folks. Right. I don't even know what the disc looked like, to be honest. I mean, obviously, I know they looked like a Frisbee. But I know that they're different. I've never really seen one.
One of these days, I'm going to break you loose, and you and I are going to give it a try.
I would love to. I am so busy. And I know you've already infected a couple of our friends.
That's true.
They've already bought stuff and are now going with you. But one day when I slow down, I'm going to have to get out there and give it a try. Well, that's about all we have for this week's episode, folks. Thank you to our sponsors for Gaia.com, Upside.com, Pretty Lights, Inner Tradition Books, New Page Books, Llewellyn Books, Anomalous Books, and Ancient American Magazine. I'm Kyle Filson. He's Cam Hale.
Peace, y'all.
Oh, no, 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 no. Who's taking you home, 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 home? And loving you so, 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 so. The way I used to love you, no, I don't wanna know, no, no, no. Who's taking you home, 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 home? And loving you so, 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 so. The way I used to love you.